Hey guys, welcome back to Grey Wolf TV. We are continuing on with Ozark onto episode 6 of season 2. So, with everything that took place in the last episode, the Snells are the ones who were risking it all and it causing outlash between everybody, between the cartel, between Marty and everything, because they're so pig-headed about, oh, we'll take care of it ourselves, even though they've just been warned that the FBI could end up being on your property, and if they find all these poppies, it's game over, casino over. The cartel aren't going to put up with this. So she's instructed, basically Marty and his wife, Wendy, to do something, sort it out. And his buddy who said, stop overthinking things and just be proactive, just get it done. Anyway, he's done it for them. And we ended the episode with the whole thing going up in flames. Now we're going to find out what the outlash is from it. So let's carry on. This is episode 6.
Promise me, you get that casino up and running.
Oh, this is for nothing.
You're going to get the hell out of here.
Sounds like anything's possible. And then I remembered this spot nearby, kind of like a hideout. Of course, Marty, he's paranoid that there's going to be a tsunami that hits the coast, but...
Oh, no. I said it was too much. I think he's just gone. She's going to have nightmares. That's going to come back to haunt her. Got bruises on her.
Buddy wanted to help us with something, but it was just too much for him.
Help us with what? Why did you let him go with you?
It just feels so stupid. I know that this was coming, but it just doesn't make sense.
I thought you didn't like him. See, teenage girls are good at that. Right from day one of them being here, she acted like he was this creepy older man that she didn't like being around, and felt as though he was watching her when she was swimming and all that stuff. And now you're crying because he's gone. They tried to put out this persona of, I'm a tough young girl, and you're like, no, you're not. You're still a kid.
His name is Camino del Rio. Ring any bells?
They start dugging your fields up, you're in trouble.
Are you Mexican?
Last he was seen, he was headed onto your property. Because I think you're hiding something. I think you're trying to destroy evidence out here.
Evidence what?
You have to prove it.
I guess we'll see.
We have a bid for a casino.
Right. Well, I'm afraid I can't allow you to have any contact with your partners because anything we turn up today could persuade them to testify against you. Any contact you have with them could compromise that.
Prick.
Asshole.
Yeah.
Prick.
Well, it's a good thing that we burned that field, at least.
Yes, it is.
It's not so good that you didn't run it by me.
They've got the money in coffins now? I wondered where they'd moved it to. Veteran support ward. You can see this is, how much this has affected the entire family.
I need to know what I'm involved with here.
I think you know exactly what you're involved in.
Do I? If we're going to have any kind of relationship, you need to start being 100% honest with me.
No, I mean, you know, you weren't answering my calls, and, I figured that I would...
He doesn't want to sign it in.
...make the rounds myself until you got back.
I wonder if, with how that was handled with Ruth, what sort of relationship we've got now between Ruth and Marty. Is it, you know, is it going to have changed... His outlook, is it going to... I mean, it's definitely changed her outlook, but at the same time, is she feeling as though it's his fault or something out of his control, or does she feel as though that was the lesser of the two evils and he had to let it happen? I don't know. I don't know whether she's ever going to say anything or not.
Call my lawyer.
Yeah, you think?
I want to hear you say it.
Say what?
We should never have gotten involved with these people.
Will the sheriff please note that Mr. Snell here is choosing to waive his Miranda rights?
We're gonna have to bring you in.
On what charge?
What? There's a county ordinance banning fires due to drought. You're a farmer, you know.
Darlene.
You need to stop coming clean.
Dell? Dell is located elsewhere.
Okay, good. And the other...
Okay, well, that's something.
Persons, are they going to cause us any problems?
I can't rightly say.
In case this is somehow unclear, targets of murder investigations are not granted casino licenses.
No, they're not.
You need to get my husband out of fucking jail.
And how precisely are we going to do that?
I understand what the birds see in you, but I'm having a hard time understanding what you see in them.
My client and the birds have no
business
ties.
If we were to look into your charity, we'd see that you're siphoning funds to help prop up your agricultural business.
He's done it in his homework, too.
Business, but I do know some people who would be.
Unless I talk about Marty Bird.
Mm-hmm.
Are you sure you want to be filming this?
I am.
That was, coincidentally, the night before your motel room sustained over $10,000 worth of damage.
You know what's going on here? You may think you've got stuff on him, dirt on him, but this guy has got money, power, and God knows how many people in his pocket. He's found the dirt on you too. This is going to be a stalemate here.
Another funny thing, when I inquired about the shooting, a local drug dealer became particularly interested.
Gotcha.
Quid pro quo.
And what do you get?
I'm free from investigation.
Feds are just trying to screw me the same way they screwed my family when they flooded us out. You can't expect me to account for every pile of bones that turns up.
No, but I can expect you to account for the ones you've killed.
Tell me where your ancestors are buried.
It is desecration. We do not disturb our dead.
All right, rot in jail then. Bye-bye.
You know that FBI guy, Petty, the one that raided Marty?
He set you up.
Mm-hmm. He still comes in here.
Sometimes.
I'll stay the fuck away from him. All I'm just saying, if that fuckwad shows up here, don't trust him. He'll use you up and spit you out.
He already has.
Look, I'm so sorry we, had a death in the family.
What the fuck's that?
He's gonna intervene. Gonna intervene. Yeah.
What the fuck, man?
It's like half your size.
Yeah.
Just stay the fuck out of it, burnout.
Exactly what I would have done.
This is Marty Bird.
So they really suspended you?
For a week? I said it was a violation of the honor code.
What a load of bollocks.
What about Wyatt?
Fucking schools today are arseholes. I don't want to say too much because it's over 30 years since I was in high school and things have changed and things have become more dangerous and a lot of things have moved on. But regardless as to what it was about, a guy twice his size and probably 3 or 4 years older at least than him has just attacked him, assaulted him, and you suspend the person who's been assaulted, the victim. What the fuck is wrong with schools? And I bet you've got it on camera too. What are you doing?
They expelled me.
What?
Jesus.
They can't do that.
There's a zero tolerance policy.
They come with him.
You were protecting Jonah. You have to fix this.
I don't meet the rules. Come on.
What? Oh, the rules about the one suspending your kid for...
Okay, Marty, now you're being a fucking prick. Now you're being a prick. I'm sorry. How would I make the rules? That, what, you're just going to wash it off? Ruth has just gone through all of this indirectly because of being around and involved with you and everything with you. And now Wyatt has just intervened to make sure that your son doesn't get his ass kicked. And you're just going to go, oh, well, now you're being a prick. And I'm sorry about this. Oh, zero tolerance for violence in schools. I'm sorry, but sometimes people need a kicking.
Before you yell at me about honesty, look me in the eye and tell me that you've never lied to us about anything.
This is Mike Fleming. Who's that?
<I'm Mike> Fleming. She knows.
It's the name on the passport you got me. I used it to open a bank account, along with two offshore accounts. One in Panama, another in Cyprus.
Listen, before you get... We don't need to make a big deal out of this.
Oh, yeah?
No.
Marty, you can't sit in this house for more than 15 minutes without being distracted.
Okay,
no,
that's
wait,
enough.
The deposits, the meetings, you're hiding from me. You're hiding from the kids. And I'm not going back to that life.
Okay, it's not a good time, Charles.
I need to talk to you.
Now
he's not home. I can't leave the kids alone.
I'm on your dock.
What?
I could have taken care of our preacher problem.
You're not just involved with the cartel. You are the cartel.
What did you tell the FBI?
Wow.
What does it matter? It was all lies. Leave, Marty.
I knew it. I knew it. I knew that was coming.
My knight in shining armor?
No, this isn't about me. You need to get out. You do that, I'll push the casino through.
I don't talk about my work with you.
She has bruises up and down her arms. Did you do that to her?
Ruth Langmore is a petty thief helping to launder money for a Mexican drug cartel.
Okay, there you go. No one knows who you are. She wants to talk to your boss. She wants everything in writing that everything you say is going to be, you know, that she's going to get some sort of deal. And you've just pretty much shown her that everything you're saying is just utter crap. You're making it all up because you're doing exactly what Ruth said to be wary of. You're going to use her and spit her back out and not give a shit and just walk away with the grand prize if indeed he ever gets to that point. He's not going to give a crap about her. And I don't even think she's ended up on any report anywhere yet because he has a boss and his boss has a boss. He's FBI. And it's about time Rachel started seeing him for what he is and that he's no better than the rest of the people that you're dealing with. The difference being is he's got a badge and he's hiding behind it and he's managing to do all of these things off book.
When they get a plea deal, when you deliver something useful.
No, bullshit.
I got you a search warrant.
Yeah, which so far is doing nothing.
Well, that's not my fucking problem. You can't keep doing this to me.
To you? Doing this to you?
Oh, that's the
Kansas City mob.
Thank you. I was going to say the mob guy, I just couldn't remember the time.
Of course they are.
Darlene's got it wrong.
I'm Jonah Byrd. Did we speak over the phone?
You're Marty's boy.
Yes, sir.
Right towards the beginning of the episode after Buddy had died, we saw them focus in on Jonah looking at an old Rolodex. I wonder if he's gone through it all to find all the contacts and that's why there's so many people turned up. I'm just wondering if that's what it is he's done here.
I found a paper reel in Buddy's room.
Rolodex.
Yeah, with all his contacts on it.
You mean Jimmy, you mean a Rolodex.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I contacted some of his friends.
I'm right,
told them
yes.
About the funeral. I don't know if those are... Okay.
Yeah, no, good idea.
Yeah, loads of people have turned up.
Bubble. No disrespect, but if there's any way that we can delay paying them until after the work actually gets done or started.
In Jimmy's memory.
All five skeletons have about a 1 to 12.5% match to Jacob Snell.
The family.
I don't understand.
The family.
Isotope analysis showed that the remains ranged from 90 to 150 years old.
You're screwed. They're all really old bodies.
But I found out that Jimmy was a war hero and that he'd won a Purple Heart. Also, he was one of the best negotiators that the United Auto Workers up in Detroit ever had.
Wow.
His friend Mike from Tallahassee, Florida, said Jimmy was the best damn chopper pilot in Vietnam.
Jesus.
He also told me that Gretchen was the love of Jimmy's life. He knew how to tell you what you need to know. He knew how to ask you things and he knew how to listen. Buddy was my best friend.
But he didn't treat you as a kid.
Thank you. So, how'd you do it?
Pardon me?
Do what? Oh, come on. So, I guess I should thank you for helping us find them.
Thanks.
That said, you'd be hearing from our lawyer.
I mean, there's a guy in Chicago, a private investigator. And if this fails, you're gonna go to him. I'm just gonna make sure that the feds can't touch the blue cat, and you're gonna get it back, okay?
I'd be surprised if he goes any further than that. Really? Wow, I'm shocked.
Sorry.
I'm sorry. I can't.
Sorry, I know.
That's what she's showing him, of course. Of course. Surprise. Okay, episode 6. Where the hell do I start with that? So, we've had our send-off of Buddy, and I thought it was really nice that Jonah had figured out... Well, first of all, he figured out how to give Buddy a proper send-off. Had no clue what a Rolodex was, but at least he found what it was and contacted everyone. I wondered where all these people was coming from, because he didn't show anything. It just showed that one little scene of him eyeing the Rolodex, and then all these people turned up at the end. You know, they'd put it to one side for the episode. Sorry to see Buddy go, but it sounds like he had a pretty full life and quite a lot of friends. Was a pretty tough guy. Won the Purple Heart. Chopper pilot in Vietnam. Damn. He's seen some stuff. And the little eulogy that Jonah gave on saying he was my only friend because of the situation he is. He's not got any friends or anything around him, has he? And he treated him more like an adult and knew what to say and how to say it, because Marty's too busy with everything that's going on and has also now found out that your son is starting to emulate what you do for a living quite well to try and get some attention. And he's still... We know why. Now, as regards what Petty's tried to do in this episode, it's gone catastrophically wrong again. Because the guy's just tackling it wrong and threatening people. And instead of using the book of law, the rule of law, he's so far past that, and so desperate to get his man, in effect, that it's crumbling around him. And when he thinks he's got something absolutely airtight, it isn't. I was kind of hoping Dell wasn't on the land, that they'd done it somewhere else, and it does appear they had done. So they were all ancestors, you know, all old bones, what she said, they were all between like 50 and 150 years old. So he's got nothing there. Jacob's released. Darlene's still playing the, oh, it's never any of our fault card, which is crazy. And the other guy, what's he called? The rich businessman. Begins with a W. Forgot his damn name now. He's shown in this episode, especially when he was pulled in to be interviewed by Petty. Of course this guy's going to have dirt on you too. He's not just going to let you sit there and try and bulldozer over him to get what you want. Petty tries to pick people at random that he thinks he can get something on them and squeeze them until he gets all the information he needs from them about Marty Bird and about the cartel, and then just discard them. That's not going to work with a guy like that. It might have worked with Rachel, which to this point it kind of has, but even now she started to question after that conversation with Ruth. And he soon turned that camera off. But he's shown his interest still, that he wants Wendy away from this, and he's asking her to leave Marty. What is he playing at? He's making a catastrophic mistake there that men in his position shouldn't make. Don't mix business with pleasure. And he's starting to blur the lines, I think, with that. But what this episode also showed with that little scene with Wyatt coming to Jonah's rescue with the school bully is Marty cannot handle high, volatile, emotional situations, because he was just like, oh, well, I can't control what the school does. Come on, let's go. And that was it. That was as far as it. He pissed me off with that. Because now Wyatt's got expelled. Jonah's been suspended, even though he shouldn't have been because he was a victim. I kind of get where they've gone with Jonah, but now that's knackered the plans that he's supposed to have that, let's face it, Ruth wants him to push for. So he's now been expelled. I don't know what's going to happen there. And I'm still unsure how the dynamic has changed between Ruth and Marty now with what happened, especially as it showed at the beginning of the episode with Ruth breaking down in the shower like that. And then that was it. She's done what is expected of her, especially from her dad. In private, no one hears you. No one sees you. Break down. Do whatever it is you need to do. And when you come out, you're back to the hard case. That's how, and that's the only, you know, discussion he was prepared to have with her. Not, you know, consoling her and making sure she's okay. He's not that type of guy. That's how he feels as though the Langmore should be. So, we're still pushing on with the casino thing for now. We said goodbye to Buddy. And Rachel at the end has now just revealed, I'm presuming that's why she made the move, because what she instigated there meant there was nothing being said, nothing being recorded. She's just revealed to him now, look, someone's listening. Because he was trying to let her know that he'd make sure she's okay and the blue cat's okay and everything. He's no idea still, because he's so narrow focused on the million golf balls that are up in the air with trying to work everything out with the cartel and the casino and the Snells and everything, that he can't see it. Damn. Right, we'll be back with episode 7 in a few days' time. If you haven't already subscribed to the channel, guys, and you enjoy Ozark or any of the other shows that I do, I would appreciate if you give the video a quick thumbs up and hit the sub button so you will know when another episode releases. And of course, as always, if you do want to watch this in full length, because this was quite a long episode, it was over an hour long, you can always just check the link in the description and you can go and head over onto Patreon and watch it over there. So I will see you for episode 7 next week. Take care.